We want you to be happy.
We want you. We want you.
No, that's a different song. That's a completely.
Want you to be happy.
Yeah. Thank you, Apple. This is not a Village People.
Well, there's thing. A lot of happy. Well,
we want happy you to be songs. A new recruit to Melt Mushrooms.
That's right. Melt Premium Mushroom Chocolates provides space in your head.
Ooh.
And your body, between your mind and your worries. They really get in there, into the cracks and crevices between your stress and your relaxation, and open things up.
Ooh.
With their own proprietary blend of sacred mushrooms that they grow themselves, and they make the chocolate themselves. It's pretty fucking amazing what they're doing over at Melt Premium Mushroom Chocolates. They are using all the finest organic, fair trade, and sustainably grown ingredients. And all bars contain lion's mane, which has a list of health benefits, a few of which are improved brain function, memory, promotes healthy energy levels, combats fatigue, slows biological aging, and hey, who can't use a little slower biological aging?
Yeah, better attitude while you're at it.
I like all these things. Plus 4 grams of their secret, magical, proprietary blend of mushrooms. Slide into their DMs on Instagram at Melt Mushrooms. That's plural, MeltMushrooms.
Melt Mushrooms.
Slide into their DMs. Ask them for one of their menus of their 10 flavors. They have organic, vegan, gluten-free options. And tell them that No Simple Road sent you. And you're going to get $20 off your first order. Because it's important to take care of your mind. Because our minds are crazy.
And I like how they say first order because there's going to be a second order.
That's true, man.
That's right.
There absolutely is going to be a second order. And make sure when you're checking out to tell them the No Simple Road saying you want that $20 off. Follow them on Instagram at Melt Mushrooms. So if you're on your way traveling to Dick's for these shows tonight, tomorrow night, and the next night.
Yes.
And you've never been there before.
We have something for you.
That's true. Or if you're going to another venue that you've never been to before, or if you're going to a venue you've been to before, go check out Venue Llama.
This applies to all of those.
To all these venues.
VenueLlama.com is where live music fans share helpful insider venue reviews and information based on their own experiences. This is a place where pro showgoers can quickly review venues and exchange seriously helpful venue intel with one another. Head over to VenueLlama.com today and sign up for your free Llama account and start reviewing venues today. Review venues in the Llama base, upload photos in the Llama gallery, and add your favorite scene-friendly businesses, websites, or podcasts to the Friends page. Go over to VenueLlama.com today. That's VenueLlama.com and sign up and start telling everybody all the secrets about all the venues that you've been to before. So that when they go, they know all the secrets.
And they can have a better time.
Right? It's all about having more fun. VenueLlama.com.
And make sure to follow them at VenueLlama on Instagram and subscribe to their YouTube channel.
Their YouTube channel has a whole breakdown of the Dick's experience for you. If you want to know some secret intel on Dick's, go check out their YouTube channel. Your stomach's growling and your head's confused and it's lunchtime or dinner time and you bust out like DoorDash app.
Not going
to
do that.
Or you like, I got to go to the store. No, you don't. Just if you live in Portland or Denver, just cruise on over to Fire on the Mountain. Pick yourself up some wings. Pick yourself up a nice pizza, a salad, some vegan wings.
One of their specials that they have going every month at every location.
And that little sweet tooth for after you're eating. Mm-hmm. You just want that little something. You can get like, you know, a fried Oreo or some kind of cheesecake smothered in some stuff. Like, it's amazing.
Yeah, always
it's always different. That's why I can't tell you more.
Who doesn't want cheesecake smothered in some stuff? Come on. I know you do. You want it. So go over to Fire on the Mountain.
Fire on the Mountain.
Tell them that No Simple Road sent you when you go in.
Be like, hey, guys, No Simple Road sent me.
And they're going to be like, cool. And then if you don't live in Portland or Denver, one of these places, you can go to portlandwings.com and get yourself some Fire on the Mountain gear. You can order their sauce. It'll be delivered right to your door. You go to the store, you get yourself some chicken wings, fry them up, pour that sauce on it. And then you listen to No Simple Road and this commercial. And then you're like, holy shit, I'm having an out-of-body experience because I'm experiencing Fire on the Mountain through distance and time and space has stopped. And I don't know what's happening. See, we provide you with everything. We're feeding you. The Grateful Dead family's hooking it up and cooking it up at Fire on the Mountain. And hey, you know what? Like I said before, a bunch of times, a million, and you're going to hear it, million one. Fire on the Mountain is in Portland. They're in Denver. And they're going to have a new location
in Bend soon.
And I heard a little bird tell me that Japan is even looking at a Fire on the Mountain. I mean, think about how cool that would be. Fire on the Mountain in a Grateful Dead themed restaurant in the middle Japan. Of Tokyo. That'd be cool. Just saying.
What?
But anyway, that, who knows if that's even true. I could be making that whole thing up, but I am not making up Portland and Denver and portlandwings.com and at FOTMPDX and FOTM Denver and FOTM Bed.
Summer is slowly coming to an end. And I love wearing my shop tour bus shirts.
Shop tour bus?
Shop tour bus?
But what?
Now, I mean, it's never too late to get t-shirts. They've got a restock of some favorites and some reboots. They even have a new design, the Althea Saturday's Child design coming out.
Oh, that's
but
cute.
But it's also heading into the time of the year when you want to get a hoodie.
Yes, it is.
Or
yes,
a trucker's hat.
For absolutely. Us hoodie addicts out there.
Good point,
this is
Apple.
The spot.
Yeah, so now you go over there and check out all the awesome things they have going on and hurry up and get yourself those hoodies. And it's never too early to start ordering gifts for people.
Ooh, that's true,
which
man.
Which they got you is. Covered there, too.
These come in a Oliver print box with one of their awesome designs on it, a bunch of extras inside, and some of you are even going to get a Grateful Dead cassette bootleg miracle in your order, and you're getting free shipping when you put in the promo code No Simple Road, all one word. Shop Tour Bus is kind enough to extend the olive branch of free shipping from their minds into your wow. pocketbook. So go over to shoptourbus.com
and put in the promo code No Simple Road. And
follow them on Instagram at Shop Tour Bus. Go check out all the dope designs. It's really neat. I promise you're going to really like it. You're going to thank me later. Bye.
Dark Star Pullover Hoodie. That's all I'm saying.
One of our favorite sponsors is back with us. Sunset Lake CBD.
Yeah.
If you're looking for CBD that actually does what CBD is supposed to do, look no further than our friends over at Sunset Lake.
Let me break it down.
Break it down, Mel.
They're sustainably farmed, meaning they avoid pesticides and use sustainable farming practices to preserve the land for future generations. One. Two, farm to table. They ship the CBD products straight from their door in Vermont directly to your door wherever you're at.
Now that's cool.
And third-party tested. They test everything with a third party to ensure quality, dosage, and safety.
You got to go over and check out sunsetlakecbd.com. They have so many products. Break it down for them, Apple.
Well, they've got some new stuff going on. Like they always had pre-rolls, but now they got really cool packaging for it. And you can get CBD pre-roll flights of all their flavors. You can get the heavy hitter flight that also throws in some of their Keef blunts. They have a new CBD recovery body lotion.
I'm excited about that.
Mm-hmm.
And what was the other?
The other one with arnica.
It's an extra strength muscle rub, 3,000 milligram with 5% lidocaine.
So look,
oh yeah, lidocaine.
If you're sore, this is the stuff you want to rub on your body to make those aches and pains go away. They even have CBD infused coffee, so you can have coffee without the little jitter that you get from caffeine, and you have it in the morning and you start your day off right. Your body feels lubricated. You're going to sleep good.
Yeah. And also they have, if you kind of forget to reorder, they've got subscriptions.
And they're giving the No Simple Road family 20%
off. 20%
off. Put in the promo code NSR20 when you're checking out at sunsetlakecbd.com. You're going to get 20% off your entire order.
NSR20.
And don't forget those cute little gummy bears.
That's right. sunsetlakecbd.com. One of our favorite sponsors is back.
No Simple Road. Yeah, here we go.
We're going to Cascade Equinox Festival.
What?
Everybody. Whoop. It's like eating dinner while you're eating dinner, me saying that, I feel like, because we're at Dick's right now. And then I'm telling myself that I'm already going somewhere else while I'm somewhere.
You're already thinking about the next meal.
Well, this is a good reason to talk about our next meal because it's going to be so delicious.
Mm-hmm. Cascade Equinox is going to be freaking amazing. And our guest this week.
Well, I was talking about what's delicious is our guest this week. Well, Cascade too, but yeah, Haley.
Guest this week is Haley Johnsen from Big Wild and her own solo music career. That she is an incredibly talented human being that is multi-instrumental. And I heard her sing here in the studio, and it was one of the most like, this is a silly word to use, but it's true. It's the thrilling experience, right? Like,
It was very emotional for me, and
that's I was like, gonna say very moving.
Yeah, very moving, and actually very profound too. Like her, what she was singing about, and just after we had this interview, that really just shared how beautiful of a person she was, and how. Like very courageous with her, like
self.
Putting herself out there. Yeah. And like learning and rising to the occasion and like all of these incredible things. And for her to sing that song that she had just created, like
just for us,
it was,
yeah, this is the first time anybody's going to hear this thing.
And Haley, thank you so much for doing that. And I apologize if I like made you feel uncomfortable that you felt like you had to, but I felt like it was right. I felt like after that beautiful conversation, your voice was the only, like the cherry on top. Like we said at the very end, it was like literally the perfect present. Like I'm so excited, not only for everybody to hear this, but for you to hear it back, because it was
what a great. Amazing conversation. And for all of you listening, the reason that I mentioned Cascade Equinox is because Haley's going to be there with Big Wild, along with Goose and Fantagram and Of the Trees,
special.
And
Pretty
special
Lights,
and Pretty Lights,
Light,
it's going to be
a stacked deck.
Mm-hmm. This festival really is like, I'm extremely proud that No Simple Road is going to be there.
Yeah.
Extremely
on
proud.
Saturday. We are going to be on stage Saturday. We don't know where yet.
I don't know. I can't remember the name of the stage that we're going to be. I know it's going to be like 4 to 5 o'clock
perfect.
On Saturday.
So 4 to 5 o'clock before, you know, you like had a nice day, you're going to go like change right before you go do that. Come check us out.
Yeah. And we are also going to be running around the festival all 3 days, doing interviews with festival goers and people that are working and all that stuff, making something rad for your memory books.
Absolutely.
And, it's going to be a good time. I hope that all of you that can and are able will get yourself some tickets. There are tickets still available. You can go to nosimpleroad.com. There's a ticketing link up there, and you can also Google Cascade Equinox and go to their website, and there's obviously a ticketing link there as well.
And then you can say that you were part of the inaugural one, because
right.
I have a feeling there's going to be many more.
You know, that this is in our home state of Oregon and Redmond. It really makes me happy that this kind of thing is happening here. It's like cross genre thing, and it's elevating the festival experience with a bunch of like workshops and people doing amazing things and artists and all, music, and it's a whole Cascade Equinox experience. And part of that experience is starting now with you listening to this conversation with Haley. And
I like how you put that, babe. Just like, this is part of the Cascade experience. So if you are going, step on the gas on this episode.
Apple, will you do me a favor, man?
What's that?
Will you hand me that bottle of water that's over there on the desk?
Oh, they're going to say step on the gas.
No, don't step on the gas. I'm driving. You navigate. And just hand me that bottle of water, please. I feel like my voice is doing that, like, what's the word? Like squishy mouth sound.
I was going to say while you, so you can stop talking, listen to Haley Johnsen, MUS. That's on Instagram, and she's got Studio Space Camp Sessions that she just put out. You can stream Goner, Fly Away, which is live from Red Rocks with Big Wild, and then she also has Fade Into You, so you can stream that. And that is, I highly, highly recommend that.
And Apple, she has some shows coming up, right?
Yes, she has. On September 8th, she will be performing Trout Lake, Washington at Trout Lake Hall. She talks about that in the interview. This is a very special venue, and you'll hear her talk about that. And then on September 9th in Sandy, Oregon, the Westy Family Campout.
Really?
And it looks like tickets are available for both of those.
Oh, okay, cool. Where can they go to get tickets?
Go. We need to go, like Mel said, Haley Johnsen, and it's Johnsen, and then you can hit her link tree, and it'll take you to all the things Mel was just talking about and other cool things.
Cool. Right on. You know, this is an artist that we hadn't been following Haley for a long time. I came to know about her through the Cascade Equinox lineup. And I have to say that this was a gem. This was finding a gem.
One of the gems was that she is a Portland native.
Yeah.
And she grew up in our kind of neck of the woods here. Like, she literally grew up in Beaverton, which is...
We did a couple of interviews here in the studio. Haley was one of them. And it just never ceases to amaze me the energy of the performer. When these musicians, when you get in their orbit, you can feel the vibe change. And Haley was one of those people that she came to the house and immediately you could feel the energy in the room elevate. And I'm super stoked for all of you to hear this conversation. Really, really excited. So we're going to do the business and then we're going to get you to the interview. How does that sound, everybody? Mel, you with me?
That sounds right. It sounds good.
Come on, get us going, babe.
Follow us on Instagram at No Simple Road. And then when you're done with that, go to nosimpleroad.com. Nosimpleroad.com is where you're going to hang out with us, because you can go and check out some past pictures and stuff that we have posted. You can go on to our merch tab and order yourself some cute new merch.
We got lots of awesome merch.
Yeah. He's got some new fun designs that are not No Simple Road. So Aaron's art, like...
Also, if you want to hit the back catalog of No Simple Road past episodes and you want to see if an artist has been on the show and you're not sure, you can go to the past episodes tab and scroll down. There's a search box. You just type in the name of the artist, and if they've been on the show, the episode will come up. That's pretty cool.
Oh, hell yeah.
I did that recently. You can also get a tarot reading from Mel and I with the Grateful Dead tarot deck. That's nosimpleroad.com. Oh, our calendar of events is up there too.
And then you can head on over to patreon.com. That is where you join our community monetarily. You're like, hey, I like what you guys are doing. You're putting out 4 episodes a month.
We're putting out 8 episodes a month.
Okay, look at that. We're putting out 2 episodes a week. 2 episodes a week. And you're like, I like what you guys are doing. I love the artists that you have on. I want to hear more. I want to go behind the scenes. Well, we have Side Rows, which is another little podcast that Corey, our producer, runs. And he interviews us and he does deep dives with us. And he has other artists that come on. And then you can be part of the No Simple Road community. Link up with some homies. Go to some shows.
Yeah.
And then
we have a new patron. Apple?
Yeah, from last week. What? I saw it was never opened.
Oh, we have a new $10 patron. Yeah. Welcome, Daniel Endy.
Okay, Daniel, welcome back.
Yeah,
and
re-welcoming
you, Daniel. It's like you never left.
That's right. If you aren't on Patreon, you're missing all the dope contents that's there, and that's a sad thing, and we don't like sad things around here.
No.
We don't shy away from them. But, you know, we want you to be happy. I said it at the beginning of the episode. So go over to Patreon.
There's one more thing.
What? 971-808-1524?
The tepid line.
That's 2 more things then.
Okay.
Several more things.
971-808-1524 is where you can call in. It's open mic night. You got 3 minutes. Tell us anything you want. Give us a show review. Tell us a story. Give us an update on your life. Whatever you want. 971-808-1524. What was the other thing?
Well, and then you can go to Apple, not Apple, our friend Apple, but Apple Podcasts.
You're more than welcome to come visit
Apple Podcasts, and go on there, and then you can be like, oh, hey, No Simple Road, 5 stars. That was an incredible episode with Haley Johnsen. And then you're like, you know what? I'm going to write in. Wow, Haley, that song was amazing. You guys always pick awesome artists. Thank you, No Simple Road. Shout out to Darwin. Boom. There it is.
What Mel's talking about is leaving us a review on Apple Podcasts. Yep. And the best thing you can do It's tell somebody you love about No Simple Road.
Yep.
Word of mouth. That's called grassroots, baby. That's how we roll around here.
Yep.
And that's how the mycelial network of the show spreads and grows. And then the mushrooms pop up and then the cows eat them and then things happen.
And everything gets stronger and better.
So everybody, you have been duly
informed
on the goings on, whatnots and happenings of No Simple Road. And it is now time for you to enjoy this conversation with a wonderful human being.
Yeah, kick back and relax, or sit up straight if you're driving and turn us up, or whatever you're doing.
Here we go.
Get ready to enjoy No Simple Road.
Without further ado, the No Simple Road crew gives you
Haley Johnsen.
Time they've done well. Have they done shows out there?
I don't know.
I've never not been out there for a show.
I've only seen like Four Peaks did stuff in Sisters, I believe, and then Gem and Jam did stuff down in like Arizona. I've never seen anything here.
Yeah. Huh.
Well, and that venue too. I haven't seen anything listed for that venue since we've been up here.
Yeah,
I think it's new, right?
No, it's the Deschutes County Fairgrounds.
It's been around a while.
That's been around.
That's not new.
Yeah.
That's not new. Listen to me.
The lineup, though, is pretty insane.
I know. For like a Central Oregon festival, it's like the biggest, it's got to be the biggest one they've ever had. But I know that the Les Schwab Amphitheater is bringing in bigger acts now all the time, too.
Wow.
Like in Bend.
Yeah.
So
how did you get on that bill? How awesome was that to get a phone call? Or
I'm not playing it personally.
It's Big Wild.
Yeah. I mean, Big Wild is big. So I don't get the calls. I just show up to the gigs that he gets. And, you know, I mean, we've played some awesome festivals this year, like Coachella, Lollapalooza.
Wow.
We did Red Rocks. And so, but it's cool to get to play a festival like in my backyard.
In any capacity.
Yeah, his backyard, because he lives right up here around the corner, like off. He lives in the area.
Oh, wow. Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Where? Tell us. No, I'm just kidding.
What a show. Hey, we're here to interview you.
Wow.
So, well, we should do introductions first.
Go ahead.
Okay. We always get right into it.
Thanks, Haley, for coming to No Simple Road today.
Yes, thanks for having me.
Yeah.
And I'm Aaron.
Aaron, hello.
And I'm Apple.
Yes, Apple.
Haley, for everybody listening that's not listening right now, why don't you tell them who you are?
So my name is Haley Johnsen. I'm a born and raised Oregon girl.
Awesome.
And I've been doing music full time for quite a few years now, but really got my start about 10 years ago. And I've just been grinding and trying to figure out how to be a full-time musician ever since.
I think you figured it out.
I think I did. I'm figuring it out.
You seem to be very, very busy all the time.
Yeah.
Just your Instagram, keeping up with that is like, holy crap. Dude,
I love to be busy. As much as it makes my life a little more chaotic, I kind of thrive on that.
Is that a thing that's always been like that?
I mean, since I joined Big Wild, that's been such an amazing experience for me, and it's definitely kept me more busy. But you know, it's balancing that and then in my own project and trying to get that off the mm-hmm. ground, it's kind of just like double duty.
Yeah.
Trying to
I can't imagine.
Make it all happen.
How do you keep it straight?
Oh girl, I
are you okay, but are you good with your calendar? You have like an organization to you, or like how does stuff actually get done? I don't know. I like
That's a good answer right there.
That is a good answer.
Well, so I do have a manager that's okay. very helpful mm-hmm. that helps me out and you know helps make connections happen. He helps me book some shows. And
shout out to the manager.
Shout out to Warren Wyatt.
Warren.
He's in Seattle. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I'm very lucky to have the free time and like not have a day job to spend most of my days doing all the organizing and doing all the communicating and just, you know, the hardest part is just, you know, yeah, trying to balance the two bands I'm in. And,
yeah.
But it's a great challenge because I'm in a very lucky position.
Yeah.
And, you know, being in Big Wild is an amazing job and it helps me also put finances towards my stuff. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I couldn't
That's ask a for blessing.
Better gig. Yeah.
That is such an amazing thing that you get to pursue your career and your quote unquote side job is pursuing your career
yeah.
and financing your dream.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I never thought I'd be a bass player. Did not see that coming.
That's what I was going to ask. We saw that it was like you get the call on the first day of your European tour. From them, and they're like, we want you to sing backup vocals and play bass, and you went and bought a bass and learned.
Yeah,
like
I that. Literally, yeah, thought I was just getting the gig as a backup vocalist. Landed in Germany to start my month long tour mm-hmm. by myself, and then they said, "Do you happen to play bass?" And I lied and I said yes.
Okay, you did.
And I bought a bass for €100 the next day, and I pretty much learned. Luckily, I didn't have to play that many songs because he was just kind of bringing the band aspect into his project that was, you know, originally like DJ show, more EDM. But it still was a huge learning curve for me because I'm a guitar player, so I could understand the layout, but like mm-hmm. it's a whole different technique. You're playing in the pocket. I was used to always playing on the rhythm, like on the one. So it was a huge learning curve for me. So I basically had that whole month on the road to learn bass and then literally went. And I had like a gig every night. I barely had any days off.
Wow.
So I would be in the back of the car while my husband's on the Autobahn driving me or after the show or on a day off, just learning. And I had 2 days, went home for 2 days and then literally from the Europe tour. And then I flew to Arizona to start like 3 rehearsals. And then we just immediately went into a month long A market tour.
Oh shit.
Like, wow. Like sold out. The whole tour was wow. almost sold out.
Are you like
terrified?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh yeah. I mean, I was trying to play it very cool,
but like that is the epitome of rising to the occasion.
Yeah.
You're going to be found out. They're going to know, yeah. but you're going to do as much as you can to find, to like make sure that
but
doesn't happen.
To me, that's on them. They didn't ask me to send them a audition for a bass.
Yeah.
So like they did there
that's come
so badass.
Did there come a point when after being with them you were like, hey, guess what? In the beginning, I didn't know how to play the bass.
You or
like
is this let it?
I did finally tell them, and they're like, what?
Whoa!
But I mean, they were like, they weren't like, what the hell? Hey?
Yeah,
they
yeah.
were just like, damn,
that's a fucking gangster.
So you pulled it off.
That is it yeah. is pretty impressive.
And I have since. I do now consider myself a bass player. I did not that first tour. I was like, are you sure you want me in your band? But, you know, when you're playing night after night, you're learning so much. And now at this point, I've been in the band for 4 years. Of course, we had quite a long break during COVID.
Right.
But I've done four bus tours with him, like 6-week bus tours with him.
Wow.
4 Red Rocks, a bunch of festivals. And so two full album cycles of his music. And this last calendar year was insane. We did a 7-week tour in the fall and festivals all summer and sometime in the fall and then jumped to start the spring tour in March for 6 weeks.
Does your husband come with you on the road?
Not on the Big Wild stuff. He okay. can't. He can't be on the bus. We got too many people.
Right.
But he'll fly out and come to like a festival or two. Usually, you know, we can only really afford to have him come out for like one. So I don't see him or my dog for like a long time.
I'm just picturing, I'm just thinking to myself, like, the reason I ask is I could picture, like, if Mel got a gig being on there, I would be like, Can I come?
Oh, you, and if you had to stay home, you'd be unbearable. I'd be like, oh my gosh, yeah, Aaron,
I'd have to fit you in the deal somehow.
And we got a dog during the pandemic for this very reason, because he's like, I need a friend when you're gone. And it turns out, like, he has a friend, but then he has to do all the dog stuff without me. So he's like, this is actually really hard, especially when it's like raining in Portland. He's like dealing with a 70-pound golden retriever in the mud and rain, and just like, man, this is what we signed up for. But
you know that, what an awesome thing, though. You know, taking the stage at Red Rocks, is it just like the most surreal, trippy thing ever?
Yeah, it's pretty crazy. I mean, that's such an amazing venue. It's, you know, you're looking up at a wall of humans.
Yeah.
Kind of looks like a bunch of zombies. Right? Like, oh. But, you know, this last time I played it, which was a few weeks ago, it was the first time that I was like, oh, it's not so bad. It's just 10,000 people. Like, I didn't actually feel like I was going to, like, hurl. I felt a lot more confident and a lot more like it wasn't as terrifying.
So then it becomes fun, right?
Yeah, then it's fun. Then it's like, once you get past the fact that there's so many people, it doesn't matter how many more thousands of people are tacked onto that. It doesn't matter. You're just like, well,
a sea is a sea.
Like Lollapalooza there, I think there was 40,000 people watching our set. It was insane. And I was just like, well, it's really an amazing feeling being in that band, because like I've been able to get past the nerves of that.
That's so dope.
But I don't know how it would be for my own stuff.
Oh,
that's a whole nother.
Oh. Okay.
As a front man singing and bearing my soul, rather than, you know, it's a little easier when you're just in the background,
in the pocket. Yeah, you can hide in the pocket.
In the pocket. I mean, there's still a lot of pressure, and I, you know, you don't want to mess up. But
well, you're killing it on that clip of the singing "Fly Away."
Oh, thank
and
you.
And everybody in Red Rocks is like singing along with it and everything. That's a great clip.
That was one of my favorite moments.
You know. Going back, you started with American Idol.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, take me through. Like, I gotta know
how long do we have?
How does that even work?
As long as you do.
This is long form.
Yeah. Okay, go. Wow. So were you just like at home singing, doing your thing, and then you're like, you know what, I'm gonna try out for this thing? Or how did it work?
I will take you back.
So okay, let's go.
I was in college. I went to Oregon State University. Studied sociology, minored in music. I was involved in the choral program. I was in the chamber choir. We toured, like, we went to China. We went to, did a tour in California.
That's cool.
So I was, like, in the classical realm, like, really honing in my theory and just my ear training and all that. And then I also was in the female a cappella group called Divine. Mm-hmm. And that was just a really fun outlet. And that's kind of what got me started, like, being a little bit more comfortable. Like, I was really terrified to sing in front of people pretty much my whole life. I really did not. I was not one of those kids on the kitchen counter with a hairbrush being like, well, everybody listen to me. I was just like, I didn't want anyone to know that I could sing for most of my life.
I totally get it.
Because I didn't like attention. I did not want, even if it was good attention, I didn't want it. It was too scary, too vulnerable. And so, mm-hmm. you know, college really, I started to be like, okay, I think I might have something here. And I started toying around with writing, picked up the guitar when I was 19 or 20, and, you know, just slowly started to get comfortable and challenge myself in that way. And then I had actually auditioned for American Idol, I would say, like, 3 years before the actual audition. I kept making it through. I went to Denver, and I didn't even make it past the cattle call. And I was like, screw this, I'm never doing that again. That was horrible. And then they finally came to Portland. They'd never come to Portland for an audition. Because back then, you couldn't do online auditions. It was all in person. All
right.
And so they finally came, and everyone's like, Haley, you got to do it. And I'm like, no, screw that show. I'm not doing it. But enough people were like, Haley, don't be stupid. And I was like,
oh,
okay.
That's cool. You have people rooting for you.
Yeah. So auditioned at the cattle call in Portland. Kept making it through. terrifyingly so, kept making it. So then I had a year left of college. I was in Corvallis still. I would drive up. They had a couple auditions with the producers. There was like a lot of auditions before you actually get to audition in front of the judges.
Right.
Spoiler alert to everybody watching that show.
Okay.
Basically, I make it to Hollywood Week, and December of 2011, I write my final paper of college, send it off. I get straight A's for the first time in my life.
Hell yeah.
And then I go to California for Hollywood Week. So I'm like fresh out of college. I'm like, this is it. This is what I'm doing. Like, I have all the time in the world. And we continued to audition until March. We went to Vegas a couple times. We went to LA a bunch. And then I made it to the top 24. And so top 12 girls, 12 guys. And suddenly it was like I had 12,000 Twitter followers. And I was like, holy shit. What do I do with this?
Nothing prepares you for that.
No, I didn't have any music out. I wasn't actively gigging. I had just played a couple open mics in Corvallis.
Jesus Christ.
And but I had been practicing my singing for a long time.
Right.
So I had something, but you know, by the time I got to play my or sing my song in the front of the live audience.
Was that the Sweet Dreams?
That was Sweet Dreams. Okay. And it was not so sweet for me. It didn't go great. And that's what got me like kicked off the show, was just like, I was just not ready. I was not ready for it. I oversang. I was pitchy. I couldn't hear myself. They made me sing it in a way I didn't want to. And I just was so out of my, I just didn't know who I was, you know? And I thought this would be a cool song, but you know, I look back on it and I'm really glad I had that experience, because when I got home, I had a little bit of post-idol depression, moved back home with my parents, but I had a mentor at the time who really was encouraging me to, she was basically putting me through boot camp. She's like, Haley, you're probably going to live with your parents for 3 years, but you better be in that back shed writing songs every day and practicing every day and starting to play in your hometown. And when I got home, I kept getting offers to play out, and I was like, wow. So I had this pressure and this sort of like opportunity after the show where I had this name in town and people wanted to hear me. And so I was like, well, I can't
not.
Yeah. So 3 years, I wrote probably like 200 songs. And finally in 2015, I put out my first EP. And from then I started to build my band. And I'm giving you like the whole story right now.
Yeah, I love it. This is great.
This is amazing.
And so it took a lot of patience. It wasn't like the quick turn and burn. It was like, okay, you're going to go home and like hone in on your craft, figure out who you are. And so ever since then, I've been pretty much, you know, various little giant nannied for a while. I've taught voice lessons, but I've always kind of been like 100% pursuing music as best I can. And so that's where I'm at now. I'm just
okay.
Yeah.
So
there's so much there.
Yeah, there's a ton there. But
the long story.
We do two episodes a week, right? Mm-hmm. And our Friday episode is our, like, we put out an interview with a musician or an author or whatever. And then on Mondays is like the No Simple Road weekly rewind. And it's just the three of us hanging out in here. And usually when we're walking down to come record, I'll think of something that we're going to talk about and we just go. Well, yesterday we were talking about obstacles to becoming yourself. Like, what stands in the way of you fully being who you are, right? Mm-hmm. And the reason I said all that is you mentioned like I was figuring out who I was, right? That's the hardest thing there is, right? Especially I would imagine in entertainment, because the world kind of seems like it wants you to put on a face to go out and do your thing, but what the fans are picking up on is the genuine human being underneath all that anyway. Mm-hmm. Is it hard to find that when you're finding your voice like that?
Is it hard to
figure out where you fit?
Oh yeah. It's, I mean, I'm still figuring out who I am,
yes.
But, right.
But you know, now that I am 34, you know, I've definitely gone through many growing pains. And, you know, I listen back to old albums I put out. I'm just like, you know, so glad I've improved on my songwriting and my singing. But I think, you know, every artist kind of, you know, you have to kind of have this brand, but it has to be both palatable and relatable to people.
And special.
And special and impressive and all these things. So I don't know. One thing I've always done is I've just always tried to write and to make the music that it feels true to me, even if it's not what's popular at the moment, because you can get really lost if you're just always chasing a trend, you know? And it's been great. I'm proud of myself for doing that, but it's also really hard because
you're paving your own way.
Yeah. And it's, I know that I'm like on the long game. You know, I know it's not going to be it's the 10-year overnight success story. You know,
so we're working on the same track.
Yeah, right? Yeah. Are we all?
No. Somehow or another, people slide in.
Yeah,
that does happen. People can and do get lucky, and kudos to y'all out there that are making it happen. But I think what you're saying deserves to be underscored. Like, you have to figure out and work hard for yourself.
Yeah.
Forget everything else. Like, you, all these people wanted something from you. You didn't have anything to give yet. You went into the woodshed and went and started to do your thing and like figured out who you were and musically.
Yeah.
You know, and like gave yourself a direction instead of just like, oh, well, they want me. And just, you know, it's so easy to just like hurry up and dot, dot, dot and do anything, you know? This is not that way.
No. And I thought after the 3 years I lived at home with my parents, and by the time I put my first album out, I was like, well, then it'll be easy. Then I'll, that'll be it. Then I'll have made it, you know, I'll get a record deal. It'll be fine.
Oh my gosh.
No, it doesn't work like that. So
is there a made it?
Huh?
Is there a made it?
I'm trying to think. I think making it is very different to different people.
Right.
And in a lot of ways, I think I have made it, and you know, other people might think the same, but to me, making it is going to be a little bit more, it's going to look more sustainable right now. Okay. It's not
like more long-term.
It's not, I don't have the fan base to sustain me. I'm still kind of like climbing up the wall and trying to get on the festivals and trying to get on the tours, trying to get a booking agent. I don't have any of that yet. I'm still very independent, and, you know, one thing I've learned is like, it doesn't matter how long you've been doing it. You can't expect success at any time, you know? And I think that that's a big ego thing. You kind of have to let go of the fact that like, oh, I've been doing this for so long. Oh, and I'm really good. Like I'm worthy. It's like, none of that matters in the music industry. It's like, they either like you or they don't. And they don't care about where you started.
Wow.
You know?
Yeah. Wow. That's harsh reality, wild. Haley. That is like a big pill to swallow.
I know.
Because what if someone happens to be the one that they don't like, and they've just been working, you know, plugging away and doing their thing, and they're just maybe not commercial or marketable or, you know, not the right sound. The hair is weird. Yeah.
Yeah. Or like, you know, I still can't seem to figure out TikTok and
join the club.
And I really gave it my go during COVID. I was like, okay. And I got some videos that got a lot of views, but then I'd see all these like really young girls just blowing up on there, 'cause they kind of knew how to use it. They know. And it was so much, it really messed with my mental health being on there all the time. And like, it still does. Like, social media is,
it can be very discouraging.
It's one of the best tools, but the most, like, really the hardest thing about this job is because you have to know how to use it. You got to be smart about it. You got to have a strategy.
This is all the same shit that we deal with, all the same stuff. It's such a weird space.
Yeah.
And as I've found, I'm fine when we're doing this. I'm great. Like, I'm in my happy place right now. I was born to do this shit.
Okay, this is very This is awesome.
Oh, thank you.
Professional podcast setup.
Oh, thank you. Cool. Yeah. We're just so glad that you live in town and that we were able to have you over. It makes it so much more memorable and fun. And it's like an experience. And we capture that, you know, and listen back. And this is so cool, homegrown. And like, you lived in Beaverton. Like, this is a huge success story. Like, I know we're just talking about measures of success, but Your character is the measure of success is what I'm talking about.
Absolutely.
I'm seeing success. Mm-hmm. Like, sure, you left your town and you did this. You're writing songs and these beautiful videos. Some of your work is so beautiful. But it's your character and what you're talking about and what you're being real about. And that there's no algorithm for that.
Well, for me, it's like I said, this is like doing this is great. When I start to look outside and compare myself to anything else, that's when I start imploding.
Yeah.
And like, oh my God, we don't have the followers that that guy has. And I think we're doing a better job than they are. But none of that even matters. It doesn't matter.
Comparison is the thief of joy.
Yes.
1,000%. Yeah, man. And
was that Woodrow Wilson?
Oh my gosh.
I don't. I've heard that. I don't know who said that though.
Theodore Roosevelt or Woodrow Wilson, two completely different people. I don't know why.
Somebody just said that the other day that we were talking to. Oh, Sam Grisman said that.
Really?
I'm pretty. Let me think.
Here, let's look it up. It is. So it gives me the quote and doesn't tell me who it was. No. Awesome. Oh. Anyway.
Okay. Way to give credit,
yeah.
Google.
Yeah. See, it starts there.
Yeah. Well, someone thinks.
I was going to say, too, as far as success, like looking at your catalog of what you've done and your songs and everything, that's a success. Because we talk to a lot of bands. Like, I love doing research and looking. I've been listening to you for a while. And there's more, and there keeps being more and everything. And one thing I always love personally is somebody that can do justice to covers.
Yes.
And Mel came home today when she came home from work today. I had listened to it a couple times today, and she had the Logical song.
Oh, yeah.
You killed that with your band. That was freaking amazing. And one of my favorite songs ever. And then, like, Dreams. And the ode to Dolores from the Cranberries from like 5 years ago.
Wow,
that's a tough one to tackle. That's her voice. Oh, I love, especially on YouTube when I can go and watch live and then listening to your London sessions. Mm. Well, about that, you got invited to go record at Abbey Road Studio.
What's the story? Okay, that all happened. I was finishing up my very first Europe tour.
Learning the bass,
yeah. So I did that whole thing. And then my manager, he set up a show or one or two shows in London for me at the tail end of the tour.
Uh-huh.
So I fly to London, meet him there. And the girl, I think it was just one show, the girl who was supposed to have the show, something happened, like a family emergency, and had to cancel the show. So I am in London. I'm like, uh-oh, I am here and don't have a gig.
Oh, no.
And so my manager, being the just tenacious dude that he is like, don't worry, we're going to figure this out. It's going to be worth it. We're going to make something happen. I'm going to make a couple calls. And I'm like, okay. And I think he had some connections at Abbey Road and basically was calling them and found out that somebody had a last minute cancellation in the coming days, maybe like the next day and a half or something later. And he's like, all right, Haley, you got 5 hours in Abbey Road.
Oh, shit.
Let's see what you can knock out. And I was like, okay. it was Studio One that was available. Studio One is where they record all the symphonies for Star Wars and Avatar and the orchestras. And, you know, I did not belong in that big space. I mean, a tiny person.
You wouldn't be there if you didn't belong.
Yeah, that's true.
But it was just hilarious.
Yeah, yeah, no, like, I get you.
And so, yeah, we set up and I just pretty much played through some of my, I felt like were my stronger songs. We did it tracks completely live. And, you know, a couple takes each song, but I was gung ho on not having to edit anything. I was like, I want it to be a perfect, like as perfect as I can take for each
song.
So yeah, in 5 hours we recorded 7 or 8 songs of mine that I had luckily been playing the past 3-4 weeks. So I was like ready.
Yeah.
I wasn't rusty. I was going in there like, I got this. Of course I was very nervous and it was very surreal and it was just kind of like, it was.
So you did deserve to be there because you were practicing and you were, they had a cancellation. You got screwed out of that gig. So it seems like it was kind of like.
And you knew the gravity of going into that Studio One too. Yeah. Like, wow.
So I'm really happy to have that. That album. It's a good moment in time. It's like a time capsule.
Yeah.
And I'll listen back to it. And I'll be like, man, I've gotten so much better since then.
Oh. You know?
But it's cool. It's still like great. It's such a cool experience. And I don't know. It's one of those moments.
That place is like hallowed ground, man. Mm-hmm. It was Mark Twain, by the way. Said.
Mark Twain.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Mark. Yes. I don't know why I named those other dudes.
It's fine.
It was somebody great.
It was one of those old guys from back then. You know, going to places like that, you can feel the history in those rooms that, you know, like that's wild to have been in there and do that. And, you know, taking those experiences and moving through them, do you feel like that makes you a better musician going through those big experiences like that and kind of integrating that into yourself, like taking the stage at Red Rocks and being feeling like you're going to puke and all that stuff? Does that come into play in who you are as an artist?
Oh yeah. Big time. Because when you're put in situations of like high pressure like that,
mm-hmm.
and you kind of can get through it successfully and be proud of yourself. It's you know, everything that I've gotten to do in my life, you know, including the American Idol thing, they've all just been these like huge, terrifying things that I didn't, like hurdles that I didn't think I could get over because I didn't know if I had the talent or the tenacity. But, you know, every time I've been able to get over that hump, it's absolutely made me a better musician and it's made me way more prepared for all kinds of scenarios, like even stuff like this. Like when I first started playing out like 10 years ago, this, I would have been here shaking. Like I would have been like overthinking everything I was saying, you know? So even getting more familiar with just how to talk and interview and just, you know, how to still perform under pressure is so huge. And
do you have like any techniques that you use or this is selfish, by the way, do you have any like breathing exercises or is there stuff that you do prior to walking on stage that you to center yourself?
You know, sometimes I do, but I'm really bad sometimes at doing that because I kind of like thrive on chaos and I really can't like calm down sometimes. So sometimes just being like and like jumping around is like the best thing for me.
Like literally getting the wiggles out.
Yeah.
That's her.
Yeah. Right, but that is something I want to work on is just like being able to really like center myself before a big thing like that. Cause sometimes I'll notice I'm not as there as I'd like to be. Mm. If I had like meditated or really like come to and just connected with myself before I went out and did that, I might've been a little bit more present. So
less in your head.
It kind of sounds like you like taming the beast, that chaotic thing. And then you have to go and like go perform right now and go do your thing. Like, because I really, like it resonates with me when you talk about like just, not wanting the limelight and when you were younger and all of this, but then inevitably you are blessed with this talent and the tenacity to see it through. So that means no matter what, you're going to have some spotlight on you because when you pick up a guitar and you have practiced and you're looking all fly, there is no way that you're not going to be the center of attention.
And you have to be comfortable with that.
Yeah. It's constantly. A crazy thing and keep experiencing it over and over. And mm-hmm. I mean, it is very uncanny how our psychology works in our own head, you know, like if you could like do a bird's eye view of everything that you've done and to see the motions that have taken place to get you where you're at. And like, yeah. It's a key thing. Like you said, being proud of yourself. Like yeah. That's usually a question that I'll ask people, because I think sometimes when we make it to higher heights than we have in our own life, and forget about anyone else, but like in our own life, we forget like your first album, like I'm so much better now. That was your best then.
Right.
And you've improved so much.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah. You were saying you were practiced. You were like, you knew the gravity of that. Maybe you could have used a little bit of like, you know, some kind of vocal refresh or some meditation, but like you were ready, you yeah. know? And so it's just kind of really strange thing to just like look at, you know, thank you for sharing your life is actually what I mean to say, is like you can kind of look over your whole life and see the unfolding of something mm-hmm. really incredible.
Yeah.
And it's still happening.
And I think that it's, you know, it's all about patience and knowing that like everything that you do, every piece of art I put out it's a time capsule. It's the best that I could have done at that point. I really struggle with being extremely hard on myself all the time. Mm-hmm. But when you, it really allows you to let go and kind of just let things be what they were. Maybe they didn't perform as well as I wanted them to, whatever. It's just being able to let go and be like, okay, well, how can I do better next time? What can I do differently for this next project? How can I approach it? You know, it's just, it's all, I'm constantly learning.
That's what I was going to say.
Like, I'm not like a master of anything. I'm like always wanting to get better. So like, to me, success is just always one-upping my last thing.
Well,
that makes sense. Absolutely. I can be down with that yeah. for sure.
Like in listening to your music from however long ago, or even us listening to an episode we did 3 years ago or whatever, like you said, that was my best at that time. And my set of skills that I had then, or you had then, were what they were then. You yeah. are coming from a completely different perspective now, years later, because you have more experience and you have, your chops are different and your training is different and you've had bigger and different things happen to you. Yeah. So your perception
of your awareness
how
is
you
different.
Should be doing totally. Stuff completely changes. And it's, I'm like you, I'm super hard on myself, and I guess it's not fair to look at stuff that we've done in the past and give ourselves shit for it mm-hmm. because
we didn't know.
You didn't know any better.
I didn't
know what I know now.
Yeah.
You know, it's not fair.
It's really, you know, you have to constantly give yourself grace in this, in any industry, but like yeah. in the creative industry, you know, it's, you're not chasing perfection. You're just chasing like, what is the most authentic thing for you at that moment? And, you know, going back to what you're saying about like, just when I couldn't sing for people, I didn't want to be in the limelight. I didn't actually come into like who I really was until I found music. Like, I truly believe that like music has saved me so much because it was aww. Always in me. And when I finally decided I was like worthy of diving into it and giving it a go, like that's
wow.
that's what started my journey and unfolding of like becoming like who I really want to be and being able to like give back to the world in my most like truest nature. Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
Yeah. Totally yeah. makes sense. Yeah, yeah.
And like if I had stayed scared and shy, you know, for the rest of my life, I might just. Who knows what I'd be doing?
I can't even picture you shy and scared. Like it doesn't.
Oh, dude. No. Ask my friends from high school. I was.
What's up, everybody? If you're like me and you're trying to do better for yourself and what you eat in this new year, I have something really cool for you. Factor's delicious, ready-to-eat meals make eating better every day way easier. Wherever tomorrow takes you, be ready with pre-prepared, chef-crafted, and dietitian-approved meals delivered right to your door. You're going to have over 35 different options a week to choose from, including keto, calorie smart, vegan, and veggie, and more. And there's even more to enjoy with over 55 nutrition-packed add-ons that help make your weekly meal planning even more delicious. What are you waiting for? Sign up and save. They've done all the math. Factor is less expensive than takeout, and every meal is dietitian approved to be nutritious and delicious. So here's what you got to do. Head to factormeals.com/nosimpleroad50 and use the code NoSimpleRoad50 to get 50% off your first box and 2 free wellness shots per box while subscription is active. That's code NoSimpleRoad50 at factormeals.com. Take all the guesswork out of trying to do the right thing for your body. Fuel up easy and fast. Go check out Factor.
But this is so great because we get to meet this person. You're just telling us a story about like your old self as far as we're concerned. Right. Like this is not the person that's sitting in front of us. And going back to what we were saying about like one-upping ourselves and stuff like that, like this constant improvement is so necessary for whatever bigger is next, mm-hmm. you know? Like, and what you were saying, babe, about like, you know, not being hard on our performance in the past, like that is us learning. Like if you were giving vocal lessons and you're like mocking or making fun of the person that you're giving lessons to and they've never done it before, like it'd be silly for you to do that, but yet we can do it to ourselves.
Yeah,
putting out our life's work at the time from this completely like newbie place. And so maybe a little bit of liberation and that will help us get to our next, you know, wonderful endeavor on more of a solid plane instead of like, you know, giving ourselves this hard time, like you better do good or some kind of weird, wacky expectations that we wouldn't expect of anyone else ever. Right. Like, I just can't believe it. It's just like, it kind of cracks me up because I think that we're in a room of people that are hard on themselves, and maybe that's a human condition.
I don't know anybody that's like, I'm so cool to myself all the time.
Yeah, well, no, but like even like you were saying, grace, those types of words, you know, they're much easily spent on other people. Mm.
Right.
And then when
it's way easier to give that advice to someone else.
Heck yeah. And then you're right. Your friend's like, yeah, girl, thank you so much. Yeah. And
I was telling her a few weeks ago, like even just self-talk in your head, like if somebody spoke to me the way that I speak to me, mm-hmm. we would be fighting.
Oh, yeah. You would be so pissed.
It'd be on.
Yeah.
Like instant. Like what the, how dare you? Like,
and you are the hardest on yourself about it. I was going to say, and I'm going to say it now to you because as recording artists, because we're recording and creating a timeline. And so have you, your first album and your singles are amazing. But you record it like we do. We record stuff, put it out there, and you're on to the next thing and constantly seeking that improvement. And we have listeners that come on board. We've been doing this 6 years now, and they're listening to which he cringes that somebody like, oh, that like episode 20 something. And we're like three. He's like, the audio was terrible. He's got a much better ear than me and Mel. He's more picky about it. But it took me forever. I had a hard time listening back to our podcast because I hated my own voice. And then I found it like, you know, you hear. But we hear that. And I'm sure you do, too. You kind of put that stuff in the past. It's part of you. But then somebody comes along that's new to your music and is like, Haley, that was amazing.
Yeah.
And see,
they have no frame of reference.
Exactly.
Yeah. And we get it all the time, but there's no way of not being.
I think the point
the
is
the one that's hard on
it's
yourself.
Hard to do something vulnerable in front of other people too.
Oh yeah.
That adding back that social media aspect, I have the hardest time with that. I just always have. I feel inauthentic, and then I'm like, well, people you know are doing it. There's a way to be authentic because you've seen it happen. So it's not impossible for you. What is your block? And like trying to like question all the way back to the roots of like, what is it? It's that being vulnerable and learning in front of somebody when you always think it should be perfect, or you should have, you know, you've never done a skill, but you think you should not mess up. Like, what are we thinking, you know? And that putting yourself out there constantly to keep that muscle, like keep going, that's so brave. It really is.
And I've really tried to kind of, you know, channel all these feelings into my songwriting, because a lot of what I write about is exactly this. Like,
okay,
I don't really write love songs. I've written a few, but you know, I've been with my guy for 9 years, you know, where that's just not what I'm interested in writing about. I'm writing about the things that stir me up, that like I'm writing a lot of times for myself, to encourage myself, to hopefully encourage other people to not be afraid to do the thing that scares them. Like, so many of my songs are about that.
Right.
And you know, I'm always like, oh no, I'm writing way too many like inspirational, like cheesy songs. Like, I got to write some other stuff. And it's like, no, like people love that.
Hell yeah.
And there's always different ways to put it. You can make it a rock song. You can make it a folk song. You can make it anything you want. But like, really, I'm all like what I'm learning in my music is I want it to encourage people. And a lot of times I will get feedback that it has. And I'm like, that's awesome. Like, I want to not just write for myself, but have it also resonate with other people. Because just like you're saying, like, you guys struggle with self-doubt and like all this, you know, looking back and being judgmental on yourself. Every single musician I know, I've had this exact conversation with. Like, there's no, even the ones who are like, I mean, I don't know, I've never talked to like Post Malone or anything like that, or like, you know,
right.
But everybody has this inner critic, and every artist has this struggle, and every human being,
right,
too. You don't have to be an artist or musician to like have these things that are like these setbacks in your life that keep you from like living up to your true potential or making a life change that you really need to make.
Yeah.
And so I don't know.
But it's crazy to do that, what you're talking about, like in front of everybody.
Yeah. Oh, it's terrifying.
Like, I'm going to stand in front of you and like open my chest up.
Yeah.
And have all of you look around for here's my 2.5 hours.
Here's my insecurity.
That's pretty hardcore,
and
Haley.
I hope it's cool.
Well, it's a different kind of show.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
I've always wondered what that is. What is that in us that, and it's always the people like what you're saying that are a little shy. I'm the biggest introvert in the world that hides it through being an extrovert.
Oh yeah. Oh, right? I'm a fake extrovert.
Exactly. 1,000%.
Yeah. I love to be home and not leave my house.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, but it's always those people that are like, I'm going to share my soul with the world, but I'm terrified. You
but
know,
don't look at me.
But don't look.
But yeah. I'm terrified.
What do you think that is in us that's like, makes us do that?
To
I'm going to share it with everybody, even though we're terrified to do it, to share.
Oh, what is it that makes us do that? I just think that we don't have a choice. Like, it's like, if you want to do this, you gotta like,
yeah.
And you know, it's funny because I get a lot less afraid. It's not really the subject matter I'm afraid of sharing when I'm performing. I don't feel like it's that scary to sing about these feelings, because I'm like, really, at the end of the day, I'm an open book. When you get me one-on-one, like, I'll tell you everything. Right. I mean, not everything, but like,
yeah,
I'm not afraid to share.
Yeah.
These deep, dark things that I struggle with, because I know that I'm not the only one who goes through it.
Absolutely not.
What I am hardest on myself on is just like, you know, speaking of like performing a live show, I get more hard on myself for like my singing and my banter. Like, how is my stage presence? My voice is feeling a little rough today. Oh no, I'm gonna be pitchy. You know, I'm more worried about like how it's coming off performance-wise.
Your actual work.
Yeah, it's gotten way easier for me to actually share and kind of be like, you know, I wouldn't consider myself a motivational speaker, but like I'm comfortable in that role. And I listen to a lot of kind of motivational speakers and self-help people, like oh God, what's her name? Not Mel Gibson. That's the man. Mel Robbins and like Brene Brown.
Oh, okay.
And
Elizabeth
Gilbert. Like, all these women who are like really gung ho on like self-love. And that's kind of like what I want to be about. and radiate for people.
I'll tell you what.
I think you are about that.
You see, I mean, watching your like live performances, can't wait to see you live, first of all, but you're very comfortable and you seem to make, I mean, you're not, it's not showing the crowd, but it seems you hear people laughing, your little banter here and there in between. You have a sense of humor. You seem very comfortable, which puts the audience at ease too and engages them more.
Yeah, it makes us as an audience kind of like open up and ready to receive when we're, you can feel that.
Yeah. And I think that putting myself like kind of not necessarily on like, I don't ever want to be on like a pedestal. It's for me, it's like, we're all here together. I'm no better than anybody. I'm not better than you. Like we all have these same problems. Let's get comfortable being uncomfortable.
Yes.
And I'll tell you what, like we're talking about social media earlier. One thing that it's done is shown that you're not alone when you're struggling with stuff. That's one of the really kind of cool things that it can do, mm-hmm. is make people feel not so isolated. And in the world that we're in right now, things are crazy. This world is wildly insane right now. And we need that. We need what you're giving, mm-hmm. as an artist. That's like the medicine for right now, mm-hmm. that in a big way.
I think. Need all of the motivational speaking and singing and comfort that we can get as a human society, not in America, like as humans. And you know, music used to not be able to travel so far back, mm-hmm. in the day. Now it's anywhere, anytime, multiple times in a row. So if somebody happens to love the sound of your voice and you're singing this message that is universal, like we're just talking about, that's what Aaron's talking about, is the medicine.
Well,
that's that salve for the spirit or for the energy body or for the breakup or the loss, you know? And that's why it's so important. And I mean, finding myself while through doing this too. And I feel like one of our responsibilities is No Simple Road is to help other people find out about people such as yourself, mm. that are doing something incredible, who has this noble, I think it's noble. I think it's a really noble thing to want to motivate people. And whether you'll call yourself that now or wait till you're comfortable doing it later, that's what you're doing. You're motivating people. You're motivating them to get off their couch, or you're motivating them to start that new job, or you know, quit that relationship, or whatever your music does. Because I know music is like your biggest BFF when you're down, mm-hmm. mm. if no one's around and you're sad or happy and you can't share it, you're gonna turn on some music.
Yeah,
right? Like that's like a thing that we all do. And so like that's, you know, what you're doing, it really is. And then like consistently one-upping yourself is really for yourself and for everyone, just as much for everybody else as well, you know.
I think I really want to, you know, my goal is to start moving forward with some new music. I just want to be more, I want to challenge myself more with my songwriting and like get a little bit deeper than I have been. Not that they haven't been deep, but like I want to be able to talk about things I'm uncomfortable talking about and singing about, and like, you know, not, I don't know, just challenge myself to be even more, I don't know if the specific is the right word, but just always challenge myself to be like, okay, well, what are you really trying to say here? Like less vague.
I get it.
Yeah.
I get
intentional.
It.
Yeah.
Intentional. And yeah, there's some topics that I'm going to be, going to have to talk about once I release a song that I'm like really scared to talk about. But that's a whole nother.
That's a whole other ball of wax.
And that's going to be, you know, a journey for me. And like, you know, I think a lot of people are going to kind of know where I'm coming from. And, but it's, you know, there's an aspect of social media that, you know, is, it's like being too, I don't know. I've always been kind of safe. Like, I don't want to divide anybody. I don't want to say what I really mean or feel like, like when it comes to politics or religion or stuff like that, you know, I've always played it pretty safe. So Same. It really is scary to kind of pick a side. Absolutely. And like say what is really going on in your head. And if you don't, then you're going to like, then you have to be okay having some haters. You have to be okay losing some fans. I know that not everyone's going to love me. I know not people are going to be like, her music sucks, or what is she talking about? Or like, you know, and that's my biggest thing moving forward is like, kind of stepping out a little bit more into the territory that's like gonna ruffle feathers.
And why
in this world that, it's you probably saw as you're saying that the three of us are all looking at each other like,
oh yeah, man,
it's
yeah.
tough. It's gotten tougher.
We did that. We did have and are doing that.
Imagine navigating COVID.
Yeah. Oh God.
With a platform that you speak on twice a week.
About your feelings and your opinions.
Without touching any of it.
Yeah,
We didn't go down any, we stayed out of it, all of it, completely.
We announced it. We were like, look,
this is
a safe space.
Yeah.
There's not very many safe spaces anymore during that time.
Oh yeah.
There was so much arguing back and forth and waiting for somebody to just say one wrong thing.
You slip, I'm out.
And so what I and we decided was like, when people tune in for during COVID, we're not going to fucking talk about it.
Because we're all in it.
Like, what else is there to talk about? Like,
We're done talking about it.
No. So, we offered the musicians a place to just either talk about what was going on with them or upcoming projects, or a lot of them had time to work on stuff. So, like...
Talk about the bright side.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And it totally worked and it kept a really neutral space. I felt like we could, everybody in that was in the scene that had so many differing viewpoints were able to just like put their feet up for an hour or 2 hours and just like enjoy. And that was most important to me during that time.
You know, it's something.
But times are changing.
Something occurred to me though, like a couple of things. We watched part of this documentary yesterday about like the San Francisco music scene during the 60s. Mm. And
you could have totally been there with this outfit today.
Dude,
the haircut, the whole thing.
That music that came out of that was a direct reflection of what was going on in the world right then and there, like the 60s and politics and the war in Vietnam and like
civil rights.
All this stuff came to a head and was reflected back at society through the lens of the music that was being created. Mm-hmm. And that's what was needed right then and there.
Absolutely.
What you're talking about, what you're doing is what's needed now. Based on what's going on in the world right now. We are not in the 60s. Vietnam is not happening right now. We have a different set of issues going on.
Way more complicated.
Mm-hmm. And people's psyches need help right now. We all need something.
Truth.
Something.
Yeah. We need someone's truth. That's the thing. stick with me. Yes, we need to be speaking our own truth. But what's going on out there is that you can't trust anything. Nothing can be trusted. You can't check your source, bro, because your source is also needs to be checked.
Yeah, your source is TikTok.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, your source is not a source.
Yeah, so there's so much misinformation that people know, and I'm not saying that like people, like when you use your intuition, you know if somebody's full of shit or someone's not. I'm not saying we can't be tricked. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that when you really know, you know. You don't have to just try to argue just to argue the point. And when someone speaks truth, like I said, their truth, a common truth, that hits like nothing else.
Yeah, a common truth, yeah.
A common truth.
Yeah. One of the songs that I did work up the courage to put on my last album kind of stemmed from a really uncomfortable conversation with some family members. And it was like my first semi-political song. It's called Common Ground. And it's not political because I'm not like saying necessarily my opinion.
You didn't plant your flag.
Yeah, but I am saying like how I'm kind of speaking on how divided we've all become and how sad it is and how like it's not really solidifying any answers. It's just saying like every day we're further away from common ground. We're taken away and looking down. Are you okay with this? Are we? And like, no. So that was a big step for me to even just kind of say something like that. But
and now you're going to take another step and another step. Yeah. And you know what? It's
these boots are made for walking.
With that too. Right.
Mm-hmm.
But it's
$20 boots from Goodwill.
Amen.
Why?
Good
why
shopper
we,
too.
Why do we worry so much about what people we don't even see or know think? We've had a pretty good track record of not having people shit on us. But the times that it's happened, I'm crushed.
Oh yeah.
Crushed. And I don't even fucking, I don't even know them.
And it's only happened a few times. Yeah. The very first one was YouTube. The YouTube bickered a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he got so.
Do not.
I was like, yeah, you guys kind of do. And it's something we got better at.
But why do you think that is? They say, let me say this right. One oh shit cancels 10,000 attaboys. It's like a thing they say in the military, right? What is that? Like we could get everybody in the comment section could be like, you fucking rule, you're so beautiful, your music's great, and then one bird's like
troll.
Yeah.
And your day's ruined.
It's ridiculous. And like I definitely play it safe. I post a lot on Instagram. Instagram's my favorite because I know that I have my people who love me on there. When I go to places like TikTok and YouTube, now that's where it gets scary.
Oh,
that's where the trolls come out to play. And like this one time,
thank you for telling me this.
I can't read my YouTube comments. I just, ever since American Idol, I can't read YouTube comments. I just can't. And people are like, why don't you respond to people's comments on YouTube? I'm like, for my mental health. Like, I can't.
That'd be a full-time job.
Yeah. Like,
responding to every comment.
Sometimes I'll accidentally glance down. It'll be like, okay, I'm not going to go any further.
One tear.
Yeah, one tear. But like on TikTok one time, during COVID, I was like, oh, I'm going to do like a kind of a voice lesson TikTok, right?
Oh, no.
And I used a trending song on TikTok of this girl's voice as an example of one way to sing. And then I gave an alternative way of singing based on how you adjust your tone. And it was strictly, I wasn't shitting on this girl's voice. I was just trying to give an example of a way of singing in the mask of your face, like kind of a little bit more like bright and forward versus singing more dark. And people got so mad. It's one of my top viewed videos because I had haters.
Oh,
come on. And a lot of people being like fighting for me in the comments because they were saying you're just like talking shit about this girl. Like her voice is so much better than yours. You suck. And because I wasn't being like, this way's better, this way's worse. I was just saying like,
it's a different way.
You're teaching technique.
You're welcome. Never fucking giving you a voice lesson again, TikTok.
Yeah, they didn't even see what you're trying to do.
And it hurts your feelings, right?
I know. I was like, what did I do? And so I stopped posting on TikTok for like a long time after that, which kind of shot myself in the foot. I should have kept going.
Yeah.
But it hurt me so much that I just like, I couldn't do it. But you know, it's really hard. We're very sensitive creatures.
We are.
So yeah, one bad comment can cancel out 100 nice things.
Yeah, it can make you shrink up and just like, oh my God, I suck.
I don't think it's like one thing or another. It's our humanity being vulnerable. And then when we're vulnerable and then we get shot down, that is like the worst feeling. You want to take your face off and put it in your pocket and walk away as fast as you can.
At what other time in history could you sit in your living room and have the world yell at you?
Exactly. Or praise you.
Yeah.
Like, and
that's true.
You know, I think sometimes I'm like, I could be a lot more like involved on social media. I should be probably doing more face videos. I should be like, I'm playing it pretty safe right now on social media. I'm posting live videos. I'm posting things that make my life look great. Like the things I want to share that I feel like are relevant. I need to promote stuff. But rarely am I going on there and like talking about the hard things. And I used to do that a little bit more, but it's really because it is so scary to be vulnerable in that space. I'm like, if it's in front of a live audience, I'll say whatever. But like for some reason, when something's static and just
captured,
then it's like, then you can get shit on all day for
all your whole life,
24/7 forever.
Yeah, but it's also like, you know, our it's being able to just get over that. It is an ego thing. And once you can kind of like harden your shell a little bit to like not be, to deflect those comments, I think that that's like, I mean, anybody who is at the top tier of anything has been shit on hard.
And they're not even looking at that stuff anymore. And their team is like, whatever.
And they don't, you know, I'm sure maybe it hurts them a little bit, but like, no matter if you want success, you're going to have to like have haters and you're going to have to just throw them away out of your brain. Do what you got to do to take care of yourself because they don't matter.
We had a publicist tell us straight up. She was like, if you guys don't have people shitting on you, you're not doing it right.
Well, we just.
And that's what Corey, our producer, Frank Corey, that's he. You guys need to upset some people. Like he wants us to shake it up. He wants us to say
nobody's
political
ever
things
mean to you guys.
And stuff.
Well, I was listening to that episode of Inside the Musician's Brain with Chris Pandolfi, banjo player for the infamous String Dusters, and he was interviewing Mike Gordon of Phish, and Mike Gordon had mentioned, yeah, Trey stopped reading comments years ago, they still find out about, you know, the scene through his daughter and their, you know, publicists and management or whatever. But like, you know that the people that you're in front of, like when you're at a show, they love what you're doing because
they bought tickets.
They're applauding. Yeah. They're looking at you. There's that reciprocal. We don't have that same connection that we do online with those people, but we love the praise that it gets, but not
the dopamine hit.
You know,
is sweet.
It is.
And so, you know, I don't know what the healthy thing is to do. Clearly, if we could all just like work on it and then don't look at it, you know, afterward, of course that would be like a, but it's not going to happen. And I feel like it's kind of like what you were saying. You're just having to constantly make yourself vulnerable to be able to allow it to be like a duck and just let it go off your back. The water's right off your back.
Haters are going to hate. Yeah, you gotta shake it off.
That's why I love Tay Tay so much. That's why I love Tay Tay because I'm telling you, they started laughing at me.
I wasn't laughing at you. I'm right on board with you.
You're right. Aaron was the one that was laughing. I love
Taylor Swift.
Man, after I saw her documentary and she was struggling with the same thing you're talking about toward the end of it, of like sticking up for her political beliefs at the time. And like
Taylor Swift.
Making a country's worth of money.
Yeah.
Well, she is this tour, the Eras tour that's going on right now. It's amazing to me the voice she has. I mean, mostly for these girls, but for everybody. Like somebody does you wrong, you go shout it from the rooftop. You don't hide. You don't be ashamed. You go, you know, you go write a song about that asshole or this or that. Mm-hmm. You don't feel bad about it. And what she's doing, it's amazing.
It is amazing.
And I have mad respect for her.
Right?
Yeah. I mean.
Shout out Tay Tay wherever you're at. We'd love to have
you
on the show.
You
want to
come on the show anytime. We'll have you.
Show you're doing right now.
Yeah.
But I will say one last thing. Like, if you are constantly seeking external validation to make yourself feel like you're worthy, you're never going to be happy. And that's the other thing I have to remind myself.
It's a void.
Like, you know, you have to be strong enough in yourself and your belief in yourself that even if you don't get that, you have to keep going. That can't be the fuel for everything. Of course, like in so many ways, like the external validation can come in the form of money because that's fans buying your tickets, it's fans buying your music, you know, so it's really tricky because of course you need it.
Right.
Yeah.
If you rely on it constantly to know that you are good at your craft, then that's a really bad headspace to be in. And I'm always working on that.
I think that's where that might be the difference between good and great is somebody starting from that place. Like they're not doing it to find out if they're good enough. They're good enough, so they're doing it.
Right, whether or not people say that they
are. Shit. If anybody hears it, sees it, this is me and I'm doing my thing.
I mean, even just deciding I'm going to go record a song because I think it's good. And like no one's told them it's good. They've just done it. They've put it out. It's like just being able to get yourself to do that is huge because plenty of people are sitting twiddling their thumbs being like, I really want to do this, but I don't know. Like, and then they're just not going to do it because they're afraid of the outcome. It's like just doing the thing, the terrifying thing, knowing that it might get shit on, knowing that maybe no one will hear it, you know, and then having to just continue to do that over and over.
And make it bigger. And make the terrifying thing bigger and bigger and bigger.
Make the
expose
higher.
Yourself a little bit more.
So, you know, we're all crazy.
If I learned anything is that we're all crazy, but we're all crazy together.
Dude, honestly, creatives, musicians, like I've definitely found my people in this life. And you know, there's nothing, even if I never make it to where I want to make it, I'm just so glad that I've surrounded myself with people who get it in a way that I get it. And I have a support system of friends, and not all my friends are musicians. I have a lot of normies as musicians.
Muggles.
And like, you know, it's, I don't know. I love all kinds of people. I don't know where I'm going with this.
No, I get you. And it's super important to have that support around you like that, especially when you're doing something like this. And you know, not for nothing, Haley, I mean, it's why I reached out to you. You're amazing.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. I remember that it was you found a video or something. We were all out on the patio and you were playing it.
Fade Into You.
Yeah.
My song, like from when I was in high school, and just remember that from like that, I think it was Mark Wahlberg movie with Reese Witherspoon and like
Fear.
Fear. Yeah. I heard that and something happened. She's, it's like my little girl brain or my young teenage brain, whatever. It was just like, I just loved what she was saying and I loved the delivery of it, and it's kind of haunting and not. And so then I'm like, you're singing it. What? I put it on and I don't even know what happened. It is so beautiful. I love that you chose that. I feel it really fits you and your vibe, and just kind of like what we talked about today is just like ethereal and magical and kind of like haunting, but like so beautiful and so like timeless. Yeah. It feels like that. And you feel like that. And I just want to say thank you for like literally gracing us with your presence. It was beautiful that you did that and came over, and thank you.
I've got one more line of questioning.
I had to say that.
This excited me.
It always falls toward the end, you know?
Well, I don't like it when we have to reschedule, but we had to reschedule. So I was doing a lot of research leading up to when you were going to come over, and they got sick and we had to cancel and stuff. But I've been following your Instagram, and I loved what is it about fucking Jared Leto, the golden god?
Oh my god.
You posted that from Lollapalooza, and I love him as an actor or person. He is a handsome, pretty man, and he can act, he can sing. There's just something about him, and you're doing that video of him, which, he's 51 years old now.
He's my age?
He's 51, and he is in better shape, and he's one of those fine wine. He's just...
He looks really good.
And he's up there. He's up there. Crawls up to the top and
he's
all that, and still has the voice.
Yeah. How was that? He's on the tent above the sound booth, essentially. He just, went out to the audience. He's running and climbing all over stuff, and then he's just,
oh my gosh.
I'm a golden god.
And it just reminded me of that scene from Almost Famous.
And she says,
you know what? We
got
to think about all of us need to get our inner Jared Leto out when we're doing that. You know what I mean? Like, if we can just channel that, like, kick ass, handsome, dope, like, what? I'm climbing up this hill when we're on our little scared moments. You know what I mean? Like,
You just have to not give a shit. And, like,
no, give a shit.
You just really do. And I'm slowly starting to give less and less of a shit.
Good for you.
Little bit
developing
little bit.
That muscle. Not give a shit muscle.
And just being, having, honestly, and I will say this is the main thing about that I want to focus on, is just having fun. This is supposed to be fun.
Yes.
And I forget that. It doesn't all have to be serious, like end of the world situation. If the show doesn't go well, I don't sell enough tickets, or like, you know, my voice cracked. It's like, who fucking cares?
No one.
Like, you're not perfect.
You're human.
Like, when I know I played a great show when I've just like unleashed and like let myself explore, let myself move around. My night not felt so like boxed in and like you know, tens.
By the numbers.
Check out Janis Joplin before you go on for 5 minutes.
I was just thinking it.
Dude, that documentary we were watching, she was screaming. Like
crooked, screaming. Hair fucked up.
Her clothes, it didn't matter. Her voice was grabbing you from your seat and bringing it in front of her. Yeah. Like, and it wasn't like, oh, that woman's beautiful, I'm going to walk closer and listen to her. No, her voice did something, and her she was so unrestricted, and it was so rad.
Unrestricted. That's the word. Huge. Yeah. That is like, that is something I want to master as a live performer, is just like getting more comfortable, just being in the flow. Mm-hmm. And like, I know, like when I am songwriting and I'm in it, I'm in this like flow state. And I feel like that is such a, it's such a difficult place to get when you're in your head and when you're thinking about all the external things and the validation you want to get. If you can just hone in on like whatever kind of thing you, spirituality you believe in there, I truly believe there's like a connection to something that you can tap into as a performer, as a songwriter, as a podcaster, like when you're just not thinking about anything else and you're just in it. And that's my biggest goal, is to just be in it.
In the flow.
Because that is what moves people.
That's where magic comes from.
And that's what everybody has shared when we're in it,
you move when you're moved.
Yes.
Okay.
That's one of the things we love so much about like the Grateful Dead and Fish and jam bands and stuff, is because the horrible mistakes and the mess ups are as good as the low peaks are as good as the high peaks and that stuff. It's truth. They're standing on the edge of the cliff ready to fall.
Yep.
Anything
that's
can happen.
Exciting.
I don't care when technical difficulties happen on stage, or I mess up, or my guitar's out of tune. It's a little annoying, but like I've learned that these things just happen, and I used to be so worried about that stuff happening.
But
now
like
I
it will.
Kinda let it happen. I let it be a part of the show, and I'm sure that there's some people who are just like, oh my God. Be professional, like whatever. But like, you know, this weekend I went to Seattle and I set up my own PA system and sound, and I played a house show for all these people, and I had so much shit going wrong. My guitar was going out of tune, my pedal board was going in and out, and like I just didn't care. I was just like,
hey man, that's part of it.
This is the real thing happening. Like, yes. I'm doing my best.
This is in real time.
I'm fucking tired, but here we are together.
Let's go.
That's truth. That's truth.
Yeah.
So I'm going to ask one silly question before we go.
I love that.
If you are in the grocery store.
Why is this always your go-to?
No, this is different.
Okay.
Oh, it's going to change it up on you.
Yeah. If you're in the grocery store and you're starving and you're going to get some kind of junk food in the cookie aisle, what cookie are you going for in the cookie aisle?
Tough question, because I don't go in the cookie aisle. But maybe if I'm in the baked goods area.
There we go. Baked goods. Okay,
there it is.
Then I'm probably going to get... This sounds so basic, but like chocolate chip cookies.
Oh no, that's not basic at all.
That's
like classic.
It's a classic. It's a classic move.
Okay.
Haley, do you feel like singing us out? Do you feel like singing us out?
Singing?
Yeah.
What do you want me to sing?
Something that kind of matches the theme of what we're talking about. Any one of your songs.
You got a guitar?
Yeah.
I'll go. I didn't warm up today.
Just so happens.
Here. Oh, we just found this guitar.
I just got my dream guitar. Finally.
What is this?
Oh my! I got my Martin.
What do you mean? This is my dream guitar.
Her name is Belle. I have a pick. Hold on, I'll get you.
Do you have a? I don't know. Oh,
capo.
Can I have a capo too? All right. Let's see.
Squeeze me. Oh.
Wow. Thank you. I gotta decide. Actually, I don't think I need it. Maybe I don't. I'll just take the capo.
You know, while you're preparing to, I was gonna throw this. I just love listening to a lot of your songs. I want to hear you do a James Bond theme song cover.
You are like. like my dad.
Really?
I can picture you singing like For Your Eyes Only, and like they're like those are such dramatic productions, and I think you just kill it. Oh, like,
you so probably do good.
I'm on board
with
your dad.
Yeah. You played this before the.
No, it'll be
what's
a
guys. Oh, so what Sage said?
Sage, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. This is like the cherry on top.
This is the cherry on top. This is a song I wrote just the other day after a little mental breakdown, feeling emotional, and I just wanted to write a song for my inner child. And I think I'm going to record it because I like it. And it's called Late Bloomer. Okay, here we go.
Gotta do this.
Wow.
You guys are gonna make me start crying.
Wow.
That was so beautiful.
Thank you. I always said thank you for the goosebumps. That's something you can't buy.
Yeah, you can't buy
that shit. I'm so nervous to sing that. Oh, sorry. What? I messed up. I don't know.
You messed up? Where?
That was the best thing I've heard all day.
Yeah, for sure.
That was thank you. Getting to hear your voice live. In our studio,
live and unwarmed up and raw dog that tape.
That was so perfect.
It was dope as shit. It sounded great in here, man.
I messed up a little lyric in the beginning.
No, you didn't.
Nobody knows but you. Well, everybody,
I feel like you wrote that for me too. I was having such a hard week, especially like having to cancel and just not feeling great and like being so hard on myself and just it's so beautiful. Thank you. I'm sorry. I'm a mess about it.
So you guys think I should release it?
I don't know. I don't know if it's going to connect with people.
it's way over everyone's head, Haley.
This other girl.
So. Well, I'm actually going to track this song tomorrow.
Oh my God. No. Yeah. Wow. Don't warm up.
No.
That raw. Just go for it, yeah. Because that's what a late bloomer needs. It needs it raw. Like that was just like, I mean it. The delivery that was so... It was perfect. It was perfect.
Thank you for asking me to sing.
Yeah.
Perfect cherry on top.
We have to. You can tell now at this point we're very emotional people.
And I love it.
We've been known
Stonewall.
We've been known like on a lot of our interviews of getting musicians to be very emotional.
Yeah.
We've had that happen several times. We're like, I didn't know you're going to make me fucking cry, man.
I was like, hearing you guys sniffling, and I was like, Haley, keep it together.
Just keep going. Just keep going.
I
have to tell you, I've wanted one of those for ever and ever, never, never, never.
That is an amazing guitar.
And I play a couple days a week with my buddy Cody, and I had been playing that Alvarez, which wasn't meant to be played by anybody ever. It was meant to be hung on the wall. And a few weeks ago, he called me on the phone. He's like, hey, I found your guitar on OfferUp for $500. And I was like, what? Send me the listing. And he sent it to me. And I was like, oh, that's cool. You know, I don't have $500. And he called me later in the day. He's like, hey, you going to be home later? I was like, yeah, why? He's like, I got the guitar for you, dude. I'm coming over. We'll work it out. We'll work out the money later. Like, this was your guitar.
To have it that bad.
So I got. So it was like a $1,500 Martin that some guy had bought and couldn't play, and was like, $500. I'm moving.
Dude, that felt really nice to play. Yes. I would love a Martin someday. I have a Taylor right now. I love my Taylor, but I also want something with a little more depth.
The Taylor's very bright. Mm-hmm. I love the it. You when you play it, you can feel it resonate on you.
I could feel it.
Yeah.
I felt it, and I wasn't playing it.
Everybody, thank you for nerding out on Martin guitars with us.
Yes. And,
is it sponsored by Martin?
Not yet. We're working on it.
Hopefully. Oh.
So
when it is, we'll let you know, Haley.
The moral to today's story is be yourself. That's the continuing theme.
Yep.
And buy tickets for Cascade Equinox Festival and go see Big Wild. And if Haley comes to your town, go see her play.
Oh, wait. Okay, Haley's got something to say about playing.
I have a show.
Yeah.
I'd love people to come to. I'm playing Trout Lake Hall on September 8th with my full band. Trout Lake Hall is an amazing venue, kind of across the river from Hood River.
Okay.
And it's a lot of people are playing there. Like, I think it's booked by the Mississippi Studios people. I think it's okay. Cool. And a lot of people are getting out there, and it's kind of out in the woods, but it is such a cool venue. And
September 8th,
bring my band out.
All right. So here's the deal. Go buy tickets now. Don't wait until the day of the show. Buy them early so that you know you're going, and then you don't have an excuse like, I don't make my
sweats.
You have
commitment issues, that's your problem.
And follower,
don't miss out. Okay.
Follower at
Haley Johnsen. Oh, wait. My website is HaleyJohnsenMusic.com, and my Instagram and socials are at Haley Johnsen MUS. Haley, HALEY, Johnsen, JOHNSEN.
Yeah.
Nice job.
And that's that. And be nice to each other, everybody.
Yes. Thanks for joining us, Haley.
Weird world.
Thank you all so much for having me.
Yeah. It's a pleasure.
Turn. and it's a journey. Wish there weren't as many problems, but it's a burden. Family needs has been deferred, and hell of means been the earth, and alchemy can bring the birth, the melody of a new border. So persistent, so resistant, so consistent, so commitment, so resilient, or haven't you learned it? One simple road. Mechanism as well as a fear. We've traveled this road before, so we may think, but it's a tad bit of strange similarities that feed an A equal A complex. The fears of your past do not equal the perplexities of the current road.
What's up, everyone? It's Joe, and I'm the host of That's Awesome with Joe, a podcast on the newly formed Sound Talent Media Podcast Network. I talk with tons of your favorite artists, managers, touring personnel, and more. Most of the time we talk about music, but lots of the time we end up talking about something completely unrelated. We laugh a lot. We do a lot of really stupid things, but also some things that are really informative and interesting. Basically, it's a podcast that I think you should listen to. Obviously, I'm biased because it's my podcast, but I think I might be into it if I wasn't the host. Check it out at soundtalentmedia.com.